Hello! Welcome to Hymn of the Week. This is our 8th Hymn of the Week. So to celebrate this completely arbitrary milestone, we're going to do something a little bit different today. So typically on the Hymn of the Week, we do a deep dive into a hymn or hymn writer, but we're not really going to do that today. Instead, we're going to address a topic that involves a lot of hymns. And as we do so together, don't worry, we're still going to sing a song together because we got to sing a hymn. That's what this is all about. So here's a little bit of background. I am the worship director at a church, and at our church, we sing a lot of hymns. I love hymns, but sometimes it doesn't seem like we sing so many hymns because whenever we do a hymn, we typically will do it within the musical cultural context we find ourselves in. So that means we do original arrangements and we orchestrate the hymn with a rock band setting typically and stuff like that. So it doesn't always sound like a hymn that we're singing, but that's what it is. But it leads to this question that I get sometimes, the question that we're going to talk about today. Why can't you do it the way it was originally written? So here's the answer to that question. First, you need to know that I'm a human being and inside of me is a heart. And that heart, there is a war for my heart. A war between the pastoral side and the snarky side. You see, the snarky side of my heart, when you ask me that question, wants to say, you want me to read a poem in German? So let's not try to be snarky today. We'll try to access the pastoral side instead. But I hope you're wearing closed-toed shoes, because I might be stepping on some toes today. So if we boil a hymn down to its basic components, we really end up with two things. First, the text, and the music. Now, getting into the text can be a little bit tricky because the hymn tradition comes mainly out of Europe. So a lot of our hymns come from there. And if you didn't know this, Europe speaks more than one language. So because of that, we have to deal with translations. Now, we're not going to get into that today, but we have an episode coming up about that. And I guarantee you it's going to be awesome. And you're never going to look at A Mighty Fortress Is Our God the same way again. But for today, we're just going to talk about English hymns and focusing a little bit more on the music side. And we're going to look a little bit about how the music and the text get combined. So maybe you haven't noticed this, but if you look in your hymnal, you'll see that most of the hymns in there, the author of the text and the author of the music are two separate people. Now, these aren't songwriting teams. This isn't like Gilbert and Sullivan, or Rodgers and Hammerstein, Simon and Garfunkel, Hall and Oates. It's none of those things. In fact, you can see in there that the birthdays and death days of people, sometimes these people lived decades apart, maybe even centuries apart. So how did that text and that music get combined in the first place? Well, I'm glad you asked. You see, when hymnals were first created, they didn't have any music in them. They just were basically books of poetry. Last week we talked about Isaac Watts and how in 1707 he published a book called Hymns and Spiritual Songs. That book is actually just a book of poetry. In fact, here's a picture of it. And this makes sense because if you think about it, in the 17th or 18th century, if you're in some rural church, the idea that the country folk around you are going to be able to read and understand music, it's probably just not there. They probably don't know how to read that. So instead, what they would do is, even though they couldn't read music, they still loved to sing. Everybody loves to sing. They still knew patriotic songs. They still knew folk songs. They knew drinking songs. They knew songs with some lyrics that might be a little blue. But they love to sing. So what they would do is they would just pair those songs that people already knew with the words that were printed in the hymnal. So the worship leader might get up, if like me, and talk about a hymn like, hey, today we're singing Amazing Grace. And then they would just mention a tune that everybody knew. So I might say, today we're singing Amazing Grace to the tune of the theme from Gilligan's Island. And then we'd all sing, Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. So how do people know that the theme from Gilligan's Island would match up with the words of Amazing Grace? Well, thankfully, we have something in your hymnal called the metrical index. You might not know that it's there. You may have never used it, but in the back of your hymnal, there's something called the metrical index, which is just a fancy way of saying this is the syllables and the stressed meters in a text that will fit to a certain song. And because we have the metrical index, we're encouraged to continue mixing melodies with text. So because so many of these songs that people would use were unique to different geographical locations, their patriotic songs might be different, their folk songs and drinking songs all might be different. So because of that, certain tunes started being favored for certain texts, but they differed from place to place. In fact, if you take a tune like When I Survey the Wondrous Cross, if I tell a bunch of people in America to sing that song, they'll probably sing a version of it that's much different to if you were in England. In England, they typically sing that to a totally different song. Same thing with Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing. They use completely different tunes because over there, in their little rural chapels and stuff like that, as they were singing texts with tunes, they just kind of found that these two worked a little bit better. But over here, people found that these two worked a little bit better. But this is going to lead to a few problems. This can lead to some confusion, like same texts, but completely different tunes.
When I survey the wondrous cross, when I survey the wondrous cross,
or times you have the same tune but different texts.
Jesus, what a friend for sinners. Come, thou long expected Jesus.
And honestly, this can get ridiculous. For example,
as with gladness, men of old, Christ who
perhaps most familiar with,
for the beauty of the earth.
In the Covenant hymnal, you can even see hymn 265 and 266 are the exact same hymn, but with completely different melodies and harmonies. So now you have all these townships and cities and different geographical locations that are kind of singing different hymns to different songs. But how did this all start to get codified? How did this all start to be associating one song with one hymn only? And well, it starts in 1861, because in 1861, I'll do that a little bigger for you. Because in 1861, there's something comes out called Hymns Ancient and Modern. And this is the first time that we finally see hymns laid out the way we think of them today. And I'm disregarding shape note singing, and if you don't know what I'm talking about, just forget I said it. But in Hymns Ancient and Modern in 1861, we see music with text set underneath it, basically the way we see it today in hymnals today. And all of a sudden, different denominations, different areas started thinking, this is a great idea. We should start developing our own hymnals just like that. And then you have people who are poring over the lyrics. What texts do we want to use? And then what tunes do we like best with those? And then all of a sudden you have these hymnal editors that are creating these hymnals. And all of a sudden, as one congregation or one denomination starts seeing the same tune always with the same text, we start thinking that they were always meant to be together. And some of them fit really nicely, which is great. But that's not the way they were originally written or anything like that. In fact, if we take a look at this book, The History and Use of Hymns and Hymn Tunes, this is a new printing, an exact reprinting of a 1903 book. And as you can see as we skim through this, you can see that there is no music at all in this history of use of hymns and hymn tunes. So, how crazy does all this really get? Well, let's take a look at All Creatures of Our God and King. The lyrics to All Creatures of Our God and King were written by William H. Draper sometime in the early 20th century, but they're based on a poem by St. Francis of Assisi, which was written in 1225, but even his poem is based off of Psalm 148, and St. Francis was Italian, but maybe his original poem, since he was a monk, was written in Latin? I don't really know. And the tune that we used for this was a German folk song from 1623, but most people know it now by the great reharmonization by the English Ralph Vaughan Williams, which he did in 1903, but in our hymnal, the Vaughan Williams is then arranged by Norman Johnson and copyrighted 1973. So when you ask me, can we sing it the way it was originally written? Are you talking about the way it is in the Covenant Hymnal, which is the Norman Johnson version based on the Vaughan Williams version, which is based on the German folk song? And do you want me to do it? I don't understand what you mean. But this is all worship. And that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to take a break and we're going to sing a song together. And if we wanted to do this song how it was originally written, I would read this poem called Faith's Review and Expectation. But instead, we're going to sing it. The words, I know you might not know the words to Faith's Review and Expectation, but I'm sure that once I start singing it, you might recognize the words. And we're going to pair it now with an American folk song. So in a way, what we're doing right now is insanely uber traditional Christianity, taking traditional folk tunes from where we are and mixing them with good theological words. Gotten all of my snarkiness out, let's take a look at my pastoral heart and what it thinks. Truly, when somebody asks me, why can't we do it the way it was originally written, I want you to know that I understand what you're really saying. What you're really saying is, Brenden, music is really important to you, but guess what? It's important to me too. And there was a time in my life when God used this particular hymn to touch me and move me and inspire me in an incredible way. And what I really want is to feel that way again, to be reminded of God's goodness, His mercy, and that those mercies are new every morning. So just wanted you to know, I know what you mean when you really say it. So if you have a favorite hymn, maybe a hymn that you always want to hear in that original way, I encourage you to think about when you first heard that hymn, how God used it in your life, what it meant to you then. And I challenge you to use that as a prayer prompting to thank God for what He has done for you.